the underground Christian.
His last word was, continue the fight, never give up.
Who faced the death penalty for standing up for his faith.
Very few people came out with a life.
On today's 700 Club Interactive. Well, welcome to 700 Club Interactive. What do you believe in? And how strongly do you feel about it? Would you fight for it? Would you die for it? Well, think about that for a moment while you hear the story of Majid Shafei. Majid is a Muslim who converted to Christianity, and then he wouldn't recant, even after he was imprisoned for his faith and beaten to within an inch of his life.
They just wanted to know who was cooperating with me, who was working with me. Telling them was not an option. Simple as that. I prefer to die.
Majid Shafei grew up in a prominent Muslim family in Egypt. But even at a young age, he struggled with Islamic beliefs and practices.
There was a lot of violence. There was no place for forgiveness. There was no sacrifice. There was no woman rights. There was no minority rights.
He was also troubled by the persecution of people in other religions, especially when he started making Christian friends in college.
I saw how peaceful they are. I saw how forgiving they are. I saw the principles and the values that they have. So I didn't understand why you want to persecute people that they are that peaceful. And I needed to know what truth that these Christians have that I was not even allowed to hear.
To get answers, Majid went to his Christian friend, Tamer, who in turn gave him a Bible.
And the more that I read, the more that I saw this amazing Lord that came on earth to die for us, for our pain and sins and disease. And I saw all of his sacrifice, all his love. That's when I came to the conclusion, that's when I came to the revelation that that's the God that we should worship. That's the God that I want to follow.
Majid committed his life to Jesus Christ.
This feeling of freedom, this feeling of liberation, there is nothing like when you know that you are a child of God and you are not a slave.
Shortly after, Majid and Tamer formed an underground organization. They used caves to hide their church services and other activities.
We built one Bible school, one medical clinic, and we established, you know, a newspaper asking from the Egyptian government to give us our rights.
The government responded by targeting the organization. One day, Egyptian soldiers discovered one of their caves and opened fire. Majid and Tamer were there.
One of the Egyptian officers aimed at me. I didn't see Tamer dead. So the officer shot, and that's when Tamer pushed me on the ground and he took a bullet and he died for me. And his last word for me was, continue the fight, never give up.
Majid escaped and continued his work. 3 months later, Egyptian police forced their way into his home and arrested him.
An officer came and he said, I need to know everything about you, who you are, who working with you. I told him, I don't know anything. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know what organization. And he told me, you want to play tough? We can play tough together. I told him, tough is my middle name. You don't need to worry about that. Next day, they transferred me to Abu Zabal prison. For the locals, Abu Zabal prison is called hell on earth.
Trying to get information, interrogators began systematically torturing Majid.
You're underground, you're bleeding from everywhere. You're beaten, there is no even a window in your cell. It's underground, it's absolute darkness. Absolute darkness. And the only thing that you can hear is the scream of the other people with you in other cells. I really thought I would die there. Very few people came out of it alive. Very few people.
After 2 days, Majid feared he would betray his friends.
Lying down in a pool of my own blood, this was my prayer. I told him, Lord, I want to thank you for your gift on the cross. I don't regret believing in you. You died for me, and I will live, and I will die for you. However, Lord, you made me out of flesh and blood. You know how weak I am. And my only request to you is to kill me before tomorrow morning.
The next day, his captors brought in dogs. Majid braced himself for the attack.
There was absolute quiet and calm. So I removed my hand away from my face just little by little. And that's what I saw. By God, all three dogs sitting around me, none of them moved one single step. The another three dogs came, sit in the same position with one little different. The middle one took a step forward and he licked my face. I got the same message that the officers got, that maybe I'm alone, but I'm not lonely. Somebody else here with me.
His interrogator returned the following day. This time, he made him an offer.
He said, you tell me the name of your friends, I will release you. I will make you witness in the case, I will release you. He listed everything that any man will desire. I looked at him, I told him, oh, that's a very good deal. I will take it. Go get me food and water, and after that, we'll talk together. He said, whatever you like, I will bring it to you. I told him, shish kebab. He went, he bring an Egyptian food, I sat down, I ate. He told me, now you tell me the name of your friends. I told him, listen, we are a big group, thousands of us. I will not remember all of us, but I can give you the name of our leader. He told me, okay, give me the name of your leader. I told him, the name of our leader, Jesus Christ. If you can catch him, catch him.
Retaliation was severe. Majid remembers enduring two more days of torture before losing consciousness and later waking up in a hospital. It took him months to recover, only to face charges of treason in Egypt's military court.
And I will tell you what I told the judge in this day. If loving Christ and if worshiping him is a crime, I'm guilty as charged, Your Honor. They give me the death penalty.
Placed under house arrest, Majid waited for his execution. He was unaware that his organization had planned a rescue.
They came with arms. They was able to attack the Egyptian soldiers. They just grabbed me. And that's when we put everything in the car, crossed to Alexandria. During this time, the Egyptian police put my pictures in every newspaper, in every magazine, every TV shows. That's when my friends told me, you have to leave the country. You cannot stay any longer.
To avoid capture, he made his way east to the port city of Taba. There, he took a jet ski and navigated his way past border patrol boats to make it safely to Israel.
And I surrendered to the Israeli police. And through Amnesty International and United Nations, I was accepted as a landed political refugee.
Eventually, Majid made his way to Canada, where today he leads One Free World International, a human rights organization committed to helping persecuted people worldwide.
He's my Lord and my Savior, my best friend. And he walks with me wherever I go. He just walks with me. Once you know that you found him, there is nothing else matter after that. Nothing else.
Nothing else matters. Once you find him, once you know him, then everything else in life fades away because you found what you were made for. The Bible says it clearly. He put eternity in our hearts. We have that sense of eternity. We know it. We know it deep within our souls. And it only gets filled when it's filled with the eternal one, the one who is the Alpha and Omega, the one who loves you infinitely. Now, here's Majid. He's growing up Muslim. He's in a prominent family in Egypt. Of all the things that his family never expected, they never expected him to become a Christian. What was the difference? What made the difference? Well, it was being around Christians, looking at them and saying, these people are different. They forgive. They love. They have a different way of approaching life. They're not bitter. They're not angry. They're not seeking revenge. They're not doing all these things. Why? What is it about them? Well, the thing about them is that they have the Eternal One in their hearts. And through Him, they're able to express these things. They're able to love unconditionally. They're able to forgive. They're able to have that light in their eyes, the joy that comes from knowing your Redeemer. If you want that, if you want to have it, it's real easy. All you have to do is ask. All you have to do is say, Jesus, if you're there, if you're real, if you really came for me, could you show me? Could you change me? And then just like Majid, he'll come. He'll be in you. He'll be all around you. He'll be your all in all. And you'll wonder, how did I do those things I used to do? How was that even possible? Who was that? Because you'll be transformed. You'll be changed into a new creation. Behold, all things can be made new. That's a promise for you. And that promise is ongoing. All things can be made new every single morning. All you have to do is come to Him. In the natural, you can't do these things. In the natural, you can't resist torture. You can't resist the offer. You can't hang in there. It doesn't work. But through Him, you can do all things. Through Him, you can have this unconditional love. You can have this forgiveness. You can have it all. If you want help with this prayer, we're here for you. All you have to do is give us a call. Number's toll free, 888-777-1999. Just call and say, I want to meet Jesus. I want to know if He's real. I want to know if He can be in my heart. I want to know if He can forgive me. Can He change me? Can He transform me? Phone call's free. Make it now. 888-777-1999. Well, up next, could we be seeing the end of Islam as we know it? Hear why some experts believe that the fastest growing religion in the world could be on the verge of collapse when we return. Well, some reports say that Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world, and that's primarily because of their birth rate. But there's another side to that story, one that you aren't hearing about, why so many Muslims are leaving their faith. Dale Hurd has the story.
The headlines say Islam is going to be the largest religion in the world, but Islam is facing a crisis. The terrible deeds of ISIS, done in the name of Allah and following the violent example of Muhammad, have horrified many Muslims who are now questioning their faith. Missionaries to the Islamic world say more Muslims have converted to Christianity since 9/11 than during the entire 14 centuries of Islamic history. Many keep their conversions a secret, afraid for their lives. In London, this British college student from a Pakistani immigrant family left Islam after a lengthy study convinced him the Quran could not be true. We hid his face because Islam teaches that apostates must be killed.
If someone leaves Islam or becomes apostate, he is thrown out of his family. His family will be the first one to abandon him. His friends will reject him. He will be killed or he will be persecuted. A lot of my friends, they said, okay, this is the last time we are talking to you because you disrespected Prophet Muhammad. You disrespected Islam.
Imran has not yet become a Christian, but has studied the Bible and says Christianity is superior to Islam. Some ex-Muslims become atheists, but some discover a God who loves.
Because of the ISIS, many people become Christian.
In Sweden, Pastor Fuad Rasho, himself an immigrant from Syria, has baptized more than 100 ex-Muslims.
Every week, I meet almost one or more who come to me. They come to me and like to know about Christianity, about Bible, because they are very angry. They are Muslim, and they don't like to continue to be Muslim.
When it comes to religion, Europe has been called the new dark continent, and some Muslims here feel trapped between atheism and radical Islam. But they see hope in Christianity.
When Nassim Ben Iman came with his parents to Germany as immigrants from a Muslim nation, he remembers thinking that if Germany is a Christian nation, then Christianity is a dead, sinful religion.
Nakedness in the television is because of the Christian religion. Living together, not married, is because of the Christian religion.
But then Nassim discovered real Christianity and is today an evangelist reaching Muslims and non-Muslims for Christ.
When the people understand who Jesus is, they will
more and more love Jesus and follow Jesus. And when the Muslims understand more and more what Muhammad is, what the Quran is, what the history is, then they will go farther away from Islam.
Islam is going to collapse.
Brother Rashid is the son of a Moroccan imam who lived for 15 years as a secret convert to Christianity. Now he hosts an Arabic language Christian program called Daring Questions that challenges Muslims to question their faith.
Many Muslims actually, they say, if what ISIS is doing is Islam, I'm leaving it. Some of them are becoming atheists. There's a huge wave of atheism in the Arab world right now. And there is also a huge wave of conversion to Christianity following Jesus Christ. I have never seen something like this. Islam was never faced with this crisis before.
Nassim says Islam appears strong, but is only feeding off the spiritual void in many weak Christian nations.
Let me say, the greatest power of the Islam is the weakness of the Christians. That's what happens in Germany and I think in America and all the Western countries.
Even while it seems that Islam is poised to overtake the West, Brother Rashid says Christians should not fear Islam, a faith that he is convinced is slowly dying.
Islam is not God's instrument to judge the West. I think people are afraid because of what they see on the news, but even violence is just a sign of collapse.
Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Well, now more than ever, we need to preach the gospel to the Muslim nations. We need to reach out to say there is a better way. You don't have to blow yourself up as a suicide bomber. You don't have to cut off people's heads to get to heaven. That's not the way. If you think that's the way, your ideas about God are wrong. We need to be with them and let them understand that there's a better way. And there's a cost to that. There's an obvious cost to that. But at the same time, we need to do that. We need to reach out to them. And CBN is doing that. CBN is the largest producer of Christian programming in Arabic in the world. And we're doing it not just in Arabic, we're doing it in Farsi, we're doing it in Turkish, we're doing it in Kabyle Berber for Northern Africa, we're doing it in Bahasa Indonesia for Indonesians, we're doing it in Hindi, in Urdu for huge Muslim population in India. We're doing it all and we want help to do that, and we also want to encourage people, if you feel called to mission work to Muslims, by all means, respond to that. Get informed. Get a way to say how is this? How can God be leading me? And respond to that. If He's calling you, just say yes. Here am I, Lord. Send me. Well, coming up, children of refugees are fleeing their countries and smiling for the first time in weeks. Find out why when we come back. Well, we here at CBN want to see Superbook spread around the world so the children of the world have the opportunity to see the stories of the Bible. In Lebanon, it's being watched by young refugees and bringing smiles to their faces.
By the end of 2015, the UN estimates there'll be 2 million refugees living like this just in Lebanon alone. It was into this place of suffering that Elian came to bring hope through Superbook to the land of her birth.
I wanted to test it and see how the kids are going to grasp this curriculum in Arabic.
The first step on her journey was a church inside Beirut, which had taken in 150 Iraqi and Syrian refugee children.
They were so curious to know, what is this Superbook? After they watched the episode, I presented the curriculum to them. I loved that they were really watching and attentive to what was going on.
Then Elian made her way into a very different situation, a camp made up of hundreds of thousands of people in the Bekaa Valley, living in tents in the most desperate conditions.
These kids were different. They were not well-groomed like the kids in the Iraqi church. You can tell that they haven't showered in a while. I heard so many heartbreaking stories. Every time I asked them, how can I pray for you? The only answer I got there was, pray that we can find food tomorrow. They don't know what tomorrow will bring them. Their homes are gone.
Then they set up and showed the Superbook episode in the beginning to nearly 200 Muslim children and adults.
While they were watching, I was watching their faces. And there was this one child. His eyes were like shining. He was so into Superbook. He was so excited to watch Superbook. To be honest with you, I was not sure if I wanted to play the salvation song there, because I always wanted to be sensitive, you know, to the environment. But I was like, let me give it a try. And the kids were actually happy, and they were singing it.
And the children responded when she introduced the Superbook curriculum to them.
We talked about God. What is God to you? Who is God to you? I asked them about sin, if they know what sin means, what it means to obey God, and they were very responsive. It was amazing how Superbook can bring joy. I spent with them like around 2 hours with, you know, watching the actual episode and talking to them, playing with them. In those 2 hours, Superbook brought a smile. It took their minds off of the sadness, the maybe bad memories.
Which brings us to the reason why Elian wanted to return to the land of her birth to bring Superbook to these children.
As I was walking in that camp, I looked at all these kids there. I saw me. I saw little Elian there, the 5-year-old Elian, who was changed because of Superbook. I grew up in a war zone. We had bombs and missiles hitting, and the only fun part of the day was when my grandmother had me watch Superbook. Superbook is planted inside me. It changed my life as a child.
Which is why Elian now believes that Superbook needs to be there for every Arabic-speaking child.
I want all the kids in the Middle East to have access to Superbook. In every house, I want to know that it's in every church and in every refugee camp. Because I know that it changed lives.
You know it changes lives when you get the stories of the Bible to children. It can change their life. It can change them for all eternity. If you want to see this happen, if you want to see every church, Arabic-speaking church, get a copy of Superbook, if you want to see the children of the world get the stories of the Bible, we're doing it. We're now in our goal, 41 languages. We're reaching around the world. There's a listing of all the different languages, all the different areas where we're broadcasting now. Season one, it's incredible what's happening. The audiences are enormous. In Philippines, over 3 million every single Saturday are watching Superbook there. You can be a part of it. How do you do that? Well, you call us, 888-777-1999. Say, I want to join the Superbook DVD Club. When you call and give a gift of $25, we'll send you out the latest episode of Superbook. If you want to get caught up on all of them, there's a place on CBN.com where you can go through the episodes, season one, season two, season three. Season three we're in production on right now. And your gift, your $25, will go into the production cost, into the translation cost, into the distribution cost, so the children of the world can get the stories of the Bible. Be a part of it. Be a part of reaching the world with these wonderful stories. Call us now, 1-888-777-1999. We leave you this word from Hebrews. If we are faithful to the end, trusting God just as firmly as when we first believed, we will share in all that belongs to Christ. God bless you. We'll see you again.